Seems as though I'm really starting to bother the egoic cartel here. At least that's what happened in a dream last night. And the sales lady for the cartel, and of course, like in real estate, it's often saleswomen. Very sleek, sophisticated, elegant, charming sales ladies who you accept them, say, you know, you're very nice and acceptable, and then they transfer that acceptance over to the house that they want you to buy. It's sort of infused with the glow that you get from them over to the house. So this cartel most definitely uses sales ladies who are very sleek, very elegant, very beautiful, very very capable of giving you a very good impression of themselves. And so I had a dream in which this sales lady was talking to this person and showing them something, showing them this really fancy building construction and everything. And what I got from that is that this egoic cartel has been stealing the energy of this person, or getting them to invest it, actually. It's investment. What the ego does is convince you to invest your energy into its plans of fabrication, to fabricate a new reality. It uses your energy. It uses your spiritual, your will. It uses your creativity. It uses it. It gets you to invest in it. And so this sales lady was basically showing this person what their investment is getting, is being put, how it's being put to work. Okay, so she said, look at this, look at this, look at this. And I got in the car, in the truck, actually, and on the right side of the truck. And the first thing the sales lady said, she turned to me and she says, you know what, you're really causing me some problems. You're causing me big problems. And she was very, very upset towards me. Now, the person in the middle was pretty much basically me, you know. And the person was emaciated, it was exhausted, it had no energy. They've invested everything. And what the sales lady wanted was them to keep investing, wants me to keep investing all my, whatever life force I have in this plan to, you know, fabricate a super nice world. And I guess would be the spirit, came into the truck and said, hey, wait a minute, you know. And I told the sales lady, I said, hey, look, it's my truck you're driving. It's my truck. You don't own the truck. I think we're going to have to replace you with a driver that has the interest, the best interest of this person, client at heart, because you completely sucked them, you know, sucked them dry of all blood, of all life force, and now you want more and more and more and more. And so we went up and looked at this complex. It was like very exotic, incredible, you know, contours and colors and everything. It was just this amazing, the lighting and everything. And then we got up there, I took a closer look at it, and it was like all built like with iron. And it was all rusting. And they incorporated the rust color into it, like the theme, as if this was something natural. But essentially what it was doing was decaying. It was decaying. And I said, wow, because this place is not worth investing in. It's terrible. And you've been swindled. You know, I've been swindled out of all my life energy. I don't even know what energy is. I got talked into giving all my energy away, which is not a good thing. Many of us in the world have had that happen to them. And it's oftentimes it's by the very slick saleswomen who make you think that they're so wonderful. And therefore, what they're representing must be so wonderful. But they're really representing this completely criminal, egoic, spiritually degenerate, wrong path, egoic cartel that is trying to get everyone enslaved to this notion of fabricating a better world. And we are enslaved. Our spiritual will is enslaved. And that's why I found that this person in the middle of the truck Jess was so completely emaciated as far as nervous energy and life force, it just could hardly function. And that's the way I feel most of the time, although I have spiritual will that I'm able to galvanize. I have this something on my side that is telling the sales lady, get lost, you know, get lost. And the sales lady is very, very expressed extreme displeasure with the spirit. So obviously something's getting to her big time. She says I'm causing her big, big problems in her job, you know, which is convincing people to can keep investing in this boondoggle. So good, making headway here. And it is these spiritual practices, these exercises, which are causing this big, big problems for this lady, for sure. And this, who represents a vast sorority of sales ladies, and who are adept at selling the ego's agenda in this world on a sort of a psychic basis, where they're able to get you to agree to give all your, invest all your energy in the plan, their plan, the plans that they represent. So this work that I'm doing, and the discipline and the spiritual will to do these exercises, is actually showing me that it is really getting to this cartel, really bothering them, causing them big problems. It should. That's good. It's good for them, because they have to eventually do it too. So, you know, it's the sooner you get started, the better. So it's a good thing that this causing them big problems, and we will continue to cause them even bigger problems. Now, here's an idea that came to me today. It's very simple. Why don't we have two worlds, two dwelling places? Let's separate this all out. Let's sort it out. Okay, there are two basic camps of people, two basic camps, and it's what I call the replicators, those who want to keep working with replication. And there's a sideline of that which I call the fornicators, who want to keep engaging in the activity of replication without replicating. So the replicators and the fornicators are one, and then the celibate non-replicators, non-fornicators, who want the vision of oneness, who want right spiritual focus, right spiritual exercise. They're not interested in replication. They're interested in reality, which is the manifestation, not replication. Replication is from the ego. Replication is from the ego. The 666 stands for replication, actually. People says it stands for the computer, but it stands for the overall egoic situation of nature, of everything replicating itself. There's none of that in reality. Reality is manifestation. It's totally different. It uses spiritual will, pure mind, you know, pure co-creation with God. So I told that lady driver in the truck, I said, hey, you know, you are trying to convince this person that their origin is other than God, and that they created themselves, and that they're their own God, etc. I said, that's wrong. What I want to do is I really want to remind this person, this being, that God is the creator. The true God is our creator, creator of spirit and truth. And what I'm advocating is turning our spiritual will towards remembrance of our creator. What created us? Not bodies. Not what created replicating instruments, replicating machines, but what created spirit? What is our true creator like? Let's remember that. So I want to be reminded of our true creator. And that sales lady's never going to do that. That's not her gig. So the Holy Spirit's job is to remind us of who our real creator is. The prime creator, the one and only prime creator, created us. The prime creator created spirit. It created our awareness. It created our identity. I want to remember what that is. I want to remember this God, this creator, and thereby. So the Holy Spirit enables us, works on that. Okay, that's what it's selling. Remembrance of our true identity, our true creator. One moment. All right, so you have these two very different groups of people. And it is entirely unfair and unjust to have either of these groups of people live under the rules, laws, expectations of the other group. It's also very awkward to try to please both. Very awkward. So we have had this try this separation of church and state. It's not working. It's not working. We had this fragile balance of church and state that we've tried to, you know, balance it out. It's not working. It's falling apart. It's becoming state. Okay, state is totally dominating right now. And that is the vast momentum of this world, is this domination by the state. Okay, by the replicators dominating religion and really getting rid of it. Forcing it to live under its rules, its regulations, its expectations, etc., etc. And this is already at a completely unpermissible extent. Totally intolerable, actually. So, in my opinion, there should be two dwelling places, not just one. And those who want to focus on right spiritual practice, attaining the vision of oneness, remembrance of the true prime creator, they should have another dwelling place, different dwelling place than this. For sure, where they live under their rules, regulations, laws, expectations, etc. Very, very different than the state, what the state is pushing. So, you know, like people fled, for instance, England for religious reasons. They wanted religious tolerance. They didn't want to be taxed too. But a lot of them came to the New World, America, to flee this you know, intolerable secular bureaucratic pressure that was being applied to them. Well, now we have this global secular bureaucratic pressure that is being applied to the whole planet. And it is totally unacceptable. So where do you flee from that? I say to another world. There should be at least two dwelling places. And probably Jesus said there are many, many dwelling places. He said that there are many rooms in my Father's mansion. If it weren't so, I would have told you. So for sure there are other dwelling places. And for sure there should be a dwelling place for those who choose to drop the agenda of projection, perception, personality, flesh, sensory perception, replication, all of that stuff. Who thingness, they're trying to achieve identity through thingness. Okay. They're dropping that. There's a path that leads you to get free of that, to recollect your spiritual will. And it's become intolerably burdensome and troublesome in this world, especially for the younger people, I find. It's just horrible. So there should be a sorting out taking place. Now, we're told at the end of this cycle, which we're at now, the wheat and the chaff will be sorted out. The wheat and the tares, that will be sorted out. The goats and the sheep will be sorted out. There'll be a sorting out process. The goats, of course, are the secular humanist bureaucratic replicators and fornicators who want to continue on with the flesh and the perception and the personality and the projection and this big personality cult, trying to fabricate something that they feel is their new reality, trying to fabricate a new reality. And so they should have their place with their laws, everything. It's fine. Let them do what they want to do. And those who want to achieve the vision of oneness, reach the vision of oneness, be reminded of God and abide in the vision of oneness and have the continuity problem cured, who are focused on that, they should have their dwelling place where they can focus on that with their rules. So it's very simple. Neither group should force the other to live under their rules. I mean, it's both ways are barbaric. I mean, the church should not have the right to force society to live under their rules and laws, because a lot of people don't want to. and they feel actually it's an attack upon them. Conversely, those the pagan, secular, humanist pagans should have no right whatsoever to force their agenda on the religious people, those who actually have right spiritual orientation. They have absolutely no right to force their agenda on them, their rules, their laws, expectations. Absolutely not. Totally barbaric. And it's essentially two groups going in completely opposite directions. And the notion that we can somehow, those are mutually compatible directions, is insanity. And I really feel this world is completely insane, thinking that somehow we can make it all work where they're mutually compatible, these two directions. They're not. So I really feel that this world, this planet, is a place where people end up who are in this extremely confused condition of thinking that mutual exclusives are compatible, which is the ego. But once you see through this chicanery and this insanity, this whimsicality, they're not compatible at all. Then I feel that you are willing to dwell in some other world, some other place that is compatible. The incompatibility of this world is because we feel that there's some way to make mutual exclusives compatible. Two different, completely opposite directions with completely opposite goals, with, you know, make them somehow equally compatible as opposed to like both of them. A little of this, a little of that. That's insanity. So I think once you see this, then you are very much aligned with the idea, let's have our planet, our place to dwell, where we can get our business done. Because we're not getting it done here. In fact, the interference of it is just incredible, how much interference there is. And it's getting quantum, every day is a quantum leap and more interference. So it's just, to me, it's a no-brainer. It's the thing to do. Absolutely the thing to do. And I believe it will happen. I believe that's what Jesus said. I'm going to make a dwelling place for those who want to be there with me for right spiritual focus, right spiritual practice. And I'll come back and I'll take you to that place. Two different worlds, two different dwelling places. One for the goats, one for the sheep. We don't want to mix the goat and the sheep up. It doesn't serve any purpose. It hurts both. It is, because I have great compassion for the pagans, because they don't want to live under strict religious laws and rules and morals and regulations. To them, it feels like their life is being suppressed and repressed and extinguished. You know, they feel that way. And so it's not fair to them. And conversely, same thing. Those who want to pursue the vision of oneness feel that this pagan secular society is a total anathema to what their goals are, and just a mockery of truth, and just something that is truly despicable, and they don't want anything to do with it, actually. So neither side should have the freedom to be free of one another. And the mixing of the two, that's just the ego's insanity, trying to play God, saying, oh yeah, I have a solution, let's just mix the two. You know, that's the ego. That's the madness of the ego. So it's better for each group to not keep trying to mix the two together. Doesn't work. Now, there's been this long effort of religions in this world to try and make it work. But as you can see at present day in this world, it doesn't work well at all. And you get this kind of pagan spirituality that, like, for instance, let's take the example of radical Dzogchen, Tibetan Buddhism, radical Dzogchen teaching. And they misinterpret it to mean like, just do whatever you want to do, everything's okay. You know, no morals, everything's equal. You know, this is a reified misinterpretation of the teachings, but it's a pagan take on this teaching, and the pagans kind of think like, hey, I kind of like that. Yeah, I can just do whatever I want to do. I can just be totally into the flesh. I can be a total fornicator, total replicator, total materialist, total greedy, whatever I want. I can just indulge my lifestyle to the ultimate, and that's perfectly okay, because it's happening right now. It's all okay. I can do that. This is a pagan take on it, and it's a wrong take, very much a wrong take. So you have this problem as the pagans are searching for some acceptable religious teaching, you know, to make at least make them please the ego, say, yeah, we can combine both. So they need something they feel comfortable with. And they sort of, they're developing this new world religion, actually. But kind of like to say, let's just blend everything together and melt it down and homogenize it. And let's come up with just kind of a basic code of just like, hey, human kindness, man. You know, human kindness. Do whatever you want to do. I don't care. Just you know, basic human kindness. That's all we need. That's all we need. That's a complete anathema to those who are, have spiritual will and determination and the right will to right spiritual practice and to reach the vision of oneness. Total anathema. Utter nonsense. Okay. Total misunderstanding. So, zero interest in living under any, this, you know, coexistence things. You know, you see these bumper stickers. Let's everybody coexist. Let's just blend all the religions together and make that. No. Blending a whole bunch of stuff that doesn't work together, that's right. Or blending stuff that does work and doesn't work, that that's better. That's worse. You try to please everybody, you please nobody here. And that's what I'm seeing. That this world is saying, oh, we're going to please everybody. No, you're not pleasing anybody. But the pagans are winning, for sure. And all the courts, the whole court system, the legal system, everything is now, these skids are greased. Where basically, what they're aiming for actually is enslaving spiritual people. And using all their energy to keep working on their fabrications, their compounding, all their efforts to fabricate an identity. If you look at the history of this planet, what is it the history of? It's the history primarily of slavery. Okay? Slavery, slavery, slavery. Right now, there's different types of slavery. We're economic slaves. We're slaves of money. We're slaves of the modern bureaucracy. We're slaves of you know, the technocracy. We're enslaved in various different ways. But all throughout history, people have been severely enslaved. The higher-ups, the one percenters, have basically dominated and enslaved the populations. And there's also the history of warfare, which basically is based on vanity, the vanity of the personality, the insecurity, and the vanity, wanting more and more and more and more, feeling always insecure. And it's a terrible history. The history of this planet is absolutely atrocious. If you've paid any attention to it at all, I've paid way too much attention to it. And unfortunately, I know all about it. And it's just the most atrocious thing. You really just have to stop studying it because it's so incredibly horrible. All coming from this, you know, mindset of... wrong direction, egoic direction, projection, perception, personality, insecurity, fear of annihilation. It's a horrible world. So who wants that world? I don't want that world. There's nothing going for it whatsoever. You look at the history of this planet, there's absolutely nothing going for it. I wouldn't pay a penny for it. Wouldn't give it a second. Really should not give this world even a second. This world is actually very... I mean, there's so many. There's other places that are so much better in this world. It's not even funny. It's a place to pursue the egoic path, the egoic agenda, and the effort to try and blend the two is just a joke. Hasn't worked. There's been a few people throughout history who may have reached the vision of oneness here and there, but by and large, if you look at, and you look at the world today, no, people are not reaching it. They're not reaching it. I know there are a lot of teachers who say they're teachers of non-dual Course in Miracles, various disciplines, this and this and this and that. Very few, even if any, are abiding in the vision of oneness. Okay, it doesn't work. And the whole planet is being turned into this secular, humanistic, materialistic nightmare with their faux spirituality. And this is a complete anathema. And basically, everyone has to live under their rules, their expectations, their laws, etc., etc., etc. It's totally unacceptable. So, two dwelling places is just a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer. And we should just realize it is a no-brainer. Just collect our spiritual will and say, yeah, we want two dwelling places. Absolutely. I, in fact, insist upon it. insist upon it. And our dwelling place will be like a gated community. The pagans cannot come in to that dwelling place. Absolutely not. The replicators cannot come in. There's no replication there. There's no replication. There's no fornication. There's no materialistic emphasis. There is right spiritual practice. And, of course, you become reaccustomed to manifestation instead of fabrication. So I don't have any problem with that whatsoever. And I'm looking forward to having another dwelling place that I can dwell in, as opposed to this place, which is, you know, just unspeakably unsuitable, I would call it. Unspeakably unsuitable. Just ridiculously so. And for me, my entire life has been this way. It's been dominated by the materialistic mindset, dominated by it. Just the way people greet each other, the body language, what they talk about, everything, from A to Z in this culture, it's all a zero. Complete flunking, total flunking. 100% F minus, you know, zero right. And again, to try to elevate this, let's just have some basic human goodness, human kindness. Of what? The personality? Personality is rotten through and through. It's fundamentally, inherently rotten. It's based on perception. Perception is inherently deluded. It is inherently insecure. It is inherently fearful. It is inherently engages in projection. Inherently so. So there's no way that could ever possibly work. Now, I don't know if I'm going to speak up about Christianity or not, because today I did some taping on my tape recorder, MP3 recorder, and basically vetted the whole situation of Christianity and what it's most likely really is. It's not a good story, actually. It's not been successful. It has not been successful. Vision of oneness is the only success there is. Anything other than that is not successful. Now, other traditions too have not been very successful. That is also very true. Very true. But some, I believe, have been a little more successful. Now, Christianity is not without some successes, some notable successes throughout history. St. Patrick actually may have been one of those. We just celebrated St. Patrick's Day. And he may be one of the rare anomalies of success from Christianity. It is possible for people to succeed with the high Christianity. The Holy Spirit can lead them, absolutely. But the Holy Spirit is not bound to any one religion at all. It's the voice of reason within us. And St. Patrick literally saw God everywhere, in everyone, in all circumstances. It seems like he may have had the vision of oneness, actually. And he converted pagans, all pagan Ireland, almost single-handedly. It was quite a... As a matter of fact, without St. Patrick, there would hardly be... Roman Catholicism wouldn't even remotely exist the way that it does now. Because what happened was, in Ireland, so many men became priests in the church. And they supplied the whole world with Irish Catholic priests, and it enabled the Catholicism to spread all over the world in the form it is now. Now you can't, I mean, last year I think there was like no vocations in Ireland whatsoever. It shows you how the paganism has spread. Now, Christianity has the high truths within it, but it's been paganized. The way I see it, it's been very badly paganized by this mindset in the world to combine mutual exclusives. This world is dominated by the belief that the combination of mutual exclusives is our salvation. And this is 100% the Antichrist egoic position. So even when you give right teachings here, the world says, okay, now we need to combine those with the wrong teachings and get this new synthesis, some psychosynthesis, integration. This is totally wrong. It doesn't work. So, Christianity in the form that we're familiar with now is this attempt to synthesize the true and the false, truth and lies, and is presented as this one package. And there's also the more cynical viewpoint of it, which has a lot of truth to it, is it has been dominated for a long time by the aristocracy and by the church bureaucracy and the church hierarchy. Essentially, the one percenters, the spiritual one percenters, have dominated it. Not entirely, okay? There are tributaries in various byways, and you know that don't quite fall under that rubric, but by and large, that is so. And what you really have is a cabal, a monopoly, an attempt by the one percenters to maintain their godlike status here in this world, basically by getting a bunch of spiritual slaves, in my opinion, to continuously tithe and give them money and gifts like the Church of the Middle Ages, the indulgences. It's a business. It's a very profitable business. Now, how did they get all the pagans to buy into this? Because let's face it, the church expanded and has membership from pagan people. Well, the aristocracy and the one percenters are very clever, egoic materialists. What they did was, if I can explain this, there's some people who already know this. For instance, Constantine. Basically, they want good soldiers. They want to win in battle. They want to conquer. They're imperialists. They want to conquer. So they're always looking for a belief system that will help their soldiers and generals and staff and everyone feel confident in battle and not afraid to die in battle. So they also are looking for some sort of spiritual, some sort of power that will enable them to win their battles. This is history. It's very important. Now, Constantine saw both of these in Christianity. It said, hey, this is a belief system that people, they actually like to die. They think when they die, they're going to paradise. And somehow it seems as though that this energy they have, that there's somehow there's some sort of godlike power. The gods are with this sort of thing. And then you'll win in battle. If you fight under this banner of Christianity, you're going to win in battle. So Constantine said, that's good enough for me. That's good enough for me. I like that. Let's make that the religion of the Holy Roman Empire. Roman Empire. Turn into the Holy Roman Empire. Now, but what is really going on? These are pagan people, actually. Most of them. They're easily converted. What do pagans want to do? They want to win in battle. Or if they die, they want to reassurance that they're going to go straight to heaven. Now, Christianity has that for them. Very, 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 in a nice package. But there's more to it. There's more to it. And this is where it gets into the heavier stuff about the death of God. And I got into that in another video. But the pagan Christianity, the way it's presented, is all about the death of God. That God, you see, let me see if we want to get into this. This is the question. Is it even worth it? I explained it beautifully today. And we got to sort out, we got to get things sorted out in this world, though, that is for sure. And the notion that, well, here it is. People here feel guilty. We feel there's something wrong with us, okay? There is. We have a severe continuity problem. Because this experience we're having has nothing to do with reality. We have totally forgot reality. This is a severe problem. Now, we want to remember reality, but the ego does not want us to remember reality, because that's the end of the ego. So the ego, its basic position is we don't have any sin. We don't have a continuity problem. There's nothing wrong with our thoughts, which are essentially, we want to kill God. Okay, there's nothing wrong with that thought. We really want to overcome the Prime Creator and replace the Prime Creator. So those are attack thoughts. The ego said, now, the ego wants us on its side. It doesn't want us to say, you know what, this notion of trying to be greater than God, that's totally wrong. And I've totally forgotten reality. I want to repent. I say, God, Honestly, I had this crazy whimsical idea that I thought I could destroy you and replace you. This is all wrong. I repent. I've forgotten what reality is like. Please remind me of what reality is like. Send the remembrance, like the Holy Spirit, send the remembrance to me so I may remember reality. That's called repentance. God says, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, there is a path for you to remember reality. No problem whatsoever. The ego hates that path and wants to do everything possible to prevent that. So what the ego wants to do is reassure everybody here in the world that the desire to kill God is perfectly okay. In fact, not only is it okay, but God has the same desire. God is also a murderer, just like you. So you're simpatico, you see. So what I see is the pagan explanation of Christianity is basically saying, hey folks, now, the bureaucrats, the one percenters who want to have all these slaves and have them people give them all these money, make enrich them and worship them, they said, you know what? The perfect religion would be a religion, the ego's telling them this, that God says, you know what? You don't have to worry about this inner guilt, feeling of feeling bad and that you're misalignment, can't remember reality. Everything's fine. Your desire to kill God is actually what God wants for you. And then people would say, oh, what a great relief. I'm so relieved. I was so nervous about the continuity problem. Now I don't have to go home. God's saying, yeah, this desire to kill God is perfectly fine. So a religion custom made for that by the one percenters would say, would have God kill its own son. And God send the son of the world so it could be killed. And God would say, look, you see? You see, I'm a murderer too, just like you. I want to destroy and kill spirit or whatever, destroy divinity, reality. So you don't have to worry about it. All you got to do is accept that this desire within you to kill God is normal. And not only normal, it's acceptable. And not only acceptable, it's how you get saved if you just keep this desire. So if you had religion set up like that, easy to convert the world. So many people would convert to that. And it would give them a sense of relief. It really would. They'll say, oh my gosh, God agrees with my desire to destroy, attack, and kill, and annihilate. In fact, look, God annihilated his own son just to prove to me that we're simpatico, you see? And so, yeah, I want that religion. That makes me feel very relieved. Though there is this enormous sense of relief when you accept the belief that God too wants to murder and destroy that which is his own creation. Of course, the ego wants to murder and destroy its own maker, so it loves this religion. The ego is our own projection of the will, and the ego wants to destroy its own maker so that this maker does not withdraw the projection. So the ego promotes this notion that which is created, destroying the creator, its maker, is a wonderful thing. That's what was supposed to happen. And then people think, hey, you know, I don't have this feeling of like, I'm not right with God anymore. At least it gives a temporary sense of relief. So easy to convert people to that. Easy to enslave them to that. And then easy to have them tithe their lives away and support this religion. So that the one percenters can live in this incredible splendor and richness. Easy. And that's what's happened. That's what's happened. If you look at history, that's what's happened. So you've got to look at it in a somewhat the cynical way because it fits the facts, actually. Now, I don't believe that's what Jesus intended at all. I think it's been twisted and distorted to suit the one percenters, as it is always done here. As it is always done here, this idea of combining mutual exclusives, everybody on the planet says, sure, that sounds right. And then it allows this madness to arise, and nobody really can question it very much. But it is absolute madness of the most whimsical type to think that God wants spirit to be destroyed, to die. It's also absolute madness to think that spirit can become flesh, become what is uncompounded, uncrystallized, that it can be crystallized and compounded. Totally impossible. So all these premises are actually totally impossible. It cannot happen. It's something that has been structured and arranged in order to create this kind of a religious slavery in people. Really, it comes from the ego, because the ego wants to promote the notion that that which is made or created is supposed to destroy. It's greater, that kind of thing. This whole notion that it's all okay. Because we think the ego's God, you see? The ego, we believe the ego is God because we have to think that it's a superior will to ours. Therefore, it's forced, we're being forced to do all the stuff we're doing instead of admitting that we're actually doing this to try to replace God. We say, no. God's the one that's forcing us to do all this. God, the ego, is forcing us to do this. So the ego promotes this, the ego wants to get rid of us. So of course it promotes the notion that God killed his only son. Because that's what the ego wants to do to us, the spirit. The ego wants to kill us. And so of course the ego wants this praying and worshiping to religion that says that God killing his only son is perfectly acceptable. In fact, it's our salvation. It sounds 100% like a totally egoic religion, actually. And this is just, you know, looking at it, and not on a judgmental plane at all, but I'm just saying, look at it, and it fits. It totally fits once you recognize what's going on with the ego and its fanatical, insane desire to destroy its maker, and our insistence that the ego is not a projection of ours, but an actually separate will that is greater than us, which means it's God. Because what has a will that's greater than ours? Only the prime creator, actually, because it was primary. So we believe we've created God. The ego is greater than us. But the ego doesn't feel it has a greater will. It feels it's dependent on us somehow. It wants to get rid of that dependency by annihilating us. So it tells us, hey, you know, here's what I want you to worship. I want you to worship the belief that God can kill its son, so to speak, right? Because we think we're the son of the ego. The ego created us. And the ego wants us. And then we feel if we worship this, the ego will be happy with us. And when we die, we'll be given a place in heaven. So it you know, looking at it in a honest way, you have to realize that it's very problematical. Now, so the ego wants everyone to worship this ideology. Okay, this ideology doesn't work. Okay, it doesn't lead to the vision of oneness. But the ego doesn't want a bunch of discord going on. So the ego gives another admonition to everybody and says, look, I'm telling everyone you must get along with one another, must love one another, you must support one another on this path, because it's very difficult. You know, you're going to have all... Of course it's difficult. Of course it's difficult. Because it doesn't work. And it's full of terror, full of fear, full of concretizations, it's full of projection, it's full of confusion, it's full of complete lack of understanding, it's dishonest with God, it lacks true repentance entirely, etc., etc., etc. It's a complete mess. So of course you're going to struggle and feel like, wow, you know, God doesn't really love me. How come I'm such a terrible sinner? I can't seem to accept the death of God's son as perfectly normal and acceptable, and this is my salvation. So the ego says, look, support one another, love one another, help each other along this path. Okay. And there you have it. There you have it. So this would be one way of looking at the situation. And, you know, it fits to an extraordinary extent what's going on. And the church hierarchy, the one percenters, have always dominated the whole thing from the beginning, actually, and have lived a life of tremendous power, authority, splendor, as if they're God's representatives here on earth. You know, and everybody worshiping them, bowing to them, and kowtowing to them, and saying, you know, giving them all their energy, all their spiritual will is given to these, this cabal, really. Now, I was in church last week, and the bishop, a tremendous, huge man, very nice man, I like the bishop, was there, and he showed up right next to me, and everybody was running, well, bishop, get your blessing, you know, I'm giving my power to you. I'm giving my power to you. You have the power to save me. You have the power to bless me. You have the power to make sure I get to heaven, all this stuff. And, you know, everybody was rushing, and I was right there, just right, you know, a foot away from the bishop, rubbing elbows with the bishop. And I just said, I just, you know, I'll give my blessing to the bishop. And vice versa, you know, we're both blessed, we're all blessed here. And there's no, I didn't have any, felt, didn't feel any need to get the bishop's blessing, and did not. And that, I said, hey, that's very interesting, very interesting. I'm not giving my power over that way. When I talk about blessing, I'm encouraging people to gather your own spiritual will and give blessings to everyone, not just to one person, to the totality of it. Bless everything equally, equal blessings, just one equal blessing to everything. Do it yourself, okay? You bless the world, bless everything. And I'm just encouraging people to do that. You're not giving your power away to any authority to do the blessing for you, okay? You're not saying I can get to heaven because I give my power away to somebody. I don't care what guru it is, what bishop, cardinal, pope, saint, whatever. Don't give your power away. Gather your spiritual will to do right spiritual exercises, which do lead to the vision of oneness, which do lead to the vision of oneness. So that's what we're doing here. So, again, I have no enmity towards the bishop at all. I think he is a very kind person and a well-spoken person, but I feel he still has a severe continuity problem, no question about it, as does everyone here, and most people refuse to recognize it, which makes them totally vulnerable to the ego, totally vulnerable to the ego, and it's mad belief you can combine mutual exclusives. What else does somebody who has a severe continuity problem and wants to go home, what else can they do if they refuse to recognize they have a continuity problem? The highest thing they can do is try to combine mutual exclusives, which ends up with this ridiculously jumbled theology and teachings, which is what I've been studying Christianity my entire life, and many religions, but Christianity has been, you know, center focus, and I've been attending church every single week for at least the last 5 years, carefully listening to everything I'm hearing in the Catholic Mass. And not to single it out, but that just happens where I've been going. I have attended Protestant services and many different Christian denominational services, and it's a complete jumble, mixed up jumble of paganism and true teachings, all kind of twisted and jumbled, trying to get them both together. That's what it is. That's what it is. It's unbelievable how the superimpositions that take place there. One moment there'll be something very profound. I say, that's just right. And the very next moment it'll be completely pagan. And then they try to fit both of those together. That is not the way to succeed. It's the way to failure. It is the way. And so, of course, what do they tell those people who give their money to them? Don't worry. Once you die, that's when you'll get your reward. They have to fall back on that. What else can they say? There's nothing else they can say, because it doesn't work. So they have to place the success in a place where you cannot testify to whether it really worked or not. You're dead. They have to do that as part of the whole deal. Whereas the real teachings say, no, you awaken right now and give testimony right now to the vision of oneness as you're living here. Okay, don't wait till you're dead. Awaken right now to the vision of oneness, and then let others see, testify to that. Because it works. The Holy Spirit works. The Holy Spirit works. But, of course, you can follow the ego and claim you're really following the Holy Spirit, too. Of course you can say that. But the Holy Spirit, if you really listen, it works. It does. And it will advise you in what spiritual practice to use. And you will get help from that. Now, there have been a lot of Christians, I wouldn't say a lot, but there have been some Christians throughout history who did listen to the Holy Spirit, for sure. For sure they did. And they got great results from it. And they tried to pass it on to others, but it's not an easy thing to pass on. It takes tremendous determination and dedication to work on this continuity problem, especially when society doesn't recognize and tries to throw every obstacle in your way possible. and insisting that you combine it with the opposite. You know, we've got to combine opposites here, is what the ego says. Combine opposites. Mutual exclusives, really. Combine pure light and pure darkness. Combine pure clarity and pure confusion. You know, combine the two as if somehow that's the answer. Well, to the ego, that's just a stalling technique. It's just a stalling technique. So, I'm not going to talk about other religions. I'm talking about the religion that I've been involved with for a long time, not just this life, but many lives. And the tradition of our culture, Judeo-Christian tradition, culture, all that stuff, I've examined it and observed it very, very, very carefully with a tremendous dedication. I say, what in the world is wrong? What is going on here? How come it's not working very well? What's the problem here? And so I'm seeing it. I'm seeing it with the help of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's the one that's pointed it out to me. He says, look at this, look at this, look at this, look at this, look at this. Of course, the ego will say, nah, you're being deceived and stuff. And no, I'm seeing the ego and that it's the deceiver. The ego's the deceiver. And so we don't have very good religion in this world, by and large. Jesus said, don't put new wine into old wineskins. Well, it would serve no purpose to try to put these teachings into a Judeo-Christian context. I know A Course in Miracles tries to do that. So far, I haven't seen much success from A Course in Miracles. I don't see success happening. Maybe it's a long, slow path, but meanwhile, the world is being taken over by secular humanism, okay? That's a pragmatic fact. And what I see in a lot of those who promulgating A Course in Miracles is they're trying to combine, they're trying to say, okay, let's fit all religions into this one religion, let's combine everything. They're trying to do that. They're trying to do the same thing. You know, compromise with the ego. So it's not really getting where it needs to get to. From what I'm seeing, I can't find any evidence that it's really getting there. No. I search there every day. I search it. Isn't there anybody out there in A Course in Miracles who's really getting it, you know? No. Don't see it. A lot of rhetoric, but no vision of oneness. It hasn't happened yet. There may be some that are anonymous that we don't know about for some reason are not saying anything. And Jesus says you may get some glimpses, but it's pretty very difficult to abide in it in this world. Well, of course it is. But it's not impossible at all. No way. It is not impossible. But pragmatically, Jesus may have a point, but only pragmatically because the times are so terrible. Because the egoic, this egoic pressure in the world is so terrible. But from the standpoint of clarity, conceptual realignment, all that stuff, we should be able to do it. It's absolutely, the path is right there. Path is right there. We may just not have the spiritual will to do it because of the world is in such a terrible situation, which is why I advocate a second dwelling place, actually. I guarantee you in a second dwelling place be a piece of cake for a lot of, for some people. It would ease things up for many people. For me, I think it would be a piece of cake. Easy. Easy. To abide in the vision of oneness, like Ramana Maharshi did. You see, how many since Ramana have been abiding in the vision of oneness? You know, I don't know. Not many, really, because the culture has changed so severely. This is stigmatized, and we say the ego says, "Hey, look, we don't want extremes. If we're going to make a deal, we don't want extremes on either side. Let's homogenize it, right?" That's what the ego's saying. Is saying, look, we're negotiating here, some sort of compromise here, so we have to, let's cut off the extremes on both sides. We won't have the extreme, you know, atheistic types, and then we won't have the extreme abidance and vision of oneness. Well, of course, the ego lied. It's tried to stop the abidance and the vision of oneness, but it's promoting extreme atheism like crazy in the world. So, it always lies. It doesn't keep its part of the bargain, and the bargain doesn't work anyway at all. So it's a very ineffective situation right now in the world. I'm all for two dwelling places, absolutely. And I was taken to one in spirit a while back and shown another dwelling place, and it is like, wow, very nice. It's ideal for right spiritual focus, right spiritual exercise, for sure. So we'll see what happens. Now, I said World War III started on March 10th. Started on March 10th. This ideational push by the ego to decide, you know what? The ego is basically going to say, you know what? You're right. It doesn't work. It really doesn't. This compromise thing doesn't work. So we need to get rid of the right spiritual practice folks, because they're just causing too many problems. And you see that taking place. You see the progressives, the liberal progressive parties beginning to dominate in many ways, and their value system being forced onto all the schoolings, all the schools, all the school system, all the workplaces, etc. Where the ego is just saying, you religious people, you're just more trouble than you're worth, and you've had your day, and it's over. It's over. This is World War III. The skirmishes have been happening, but I feel that a big concerted attempt, a unified attempt, is going to take place, which is, I think, is better called a World War III rather than all the skirmishes. There's been many, many, much guerrilla warfare and skirmishes going on between these different back groups. And I believe, at some point, the all-out war is going to take place, ideological warfare. And it may have physical components to it. It may be an actual physical World War III also. Very interesting, the Trident symbology that I actually noticed on my own, and then I started seeing if anybody else had seen it, and actually there are other people who have seen it. So not everybody's asleep. For instance, the Malaysian Airlines, I looked at the Malaysian Airlines the logo, and I said, hey, wait a minute, this looks eerily similar to the Ukrainian logo. Is it like a trident thing, you know? In Malaysian's a double trident. Also, I looked up, I said, this, it's actually a five, it looks like a five-pointed menorah, you know, for Hanukkah. Actually, Hanukkah has 9 candles, one for each day, and I think the 9th one in the middle, the 8 days of Hanukkah Festival of Lights. And sometimes there's a 7 candle for in the temple. Moses got a 7 candle menorah for use in the temple, and then that's what Moses was instructed. And then there's also a 5 candle menorah for services where the cantor is talking about, I believe it's called the cantor, I'm not sure, but for mournful services for the dead. Mournful services for the dead is the 5 candle menorah. Well, the Malaysian symbol, I know they say, well, this comes from a kite. Sure, it does, but it's also a 5-pointed menorah, and it's also a double trident. The symbol of Ukraine is a trident, okay? It is a trident. Now, these are being recognized, and the people also point out the Maserati commercial, which, very interesting. I didn't see it. I didn't watch the Super Bowl. It was in the Super Bowl. I have had several instances after praying to the Holy Spirit of suddenly a Maserati pulling in front of me. And I noticed its Trident logo. It's unmistakable. I said, whoa, this is, something's being shown to me here. Absolutely clear to me. It's happened several times recently. And I said, that Maserati means something. Maserati also means Maz, fire sacrifice, or spirit, some sort of sacrifice, fire sacrifice. Arati is the worshiping of this fire, actually, in Hindu religious practice. Arati. And I call it Maserati. You know, the goddess of destructivities, Arati, her play with fire. Maserati, the trident is a very sharp trident. The trident is a symbol of warfare, most definitely a symbol. Shiva, the spirit of Shiva in Hindu iconography or whatever. it is the trident, you know. Shiva's got that trident. You see these yogis with their trident. They put the trident on their forehead. Okay, those who are advocates of Shiva put on their forehead the 3 marks are symbolize the trident. Now, there's one thing, and others point out the World Trade Center, the memorial has 2 tridents, one bigger and one smaller, like the Malaysian double trident. There's one thing they all miss, though, but I got this, and I didn't see anybody on the internet that's got this, and it's huge. It's absolutely huge. Comet Ison. Comet Ison. You go look at this picture of Comet Ison, the one that looks like the crop circle. The one that looks like this flying bird or something, this incredible thing. What is it? It's the trident. It's the double trident. Clear as a bell. Clear as a bell. Comet Ice on the pier. There's a trident in the